And now to introduce today's host. Joachim Pissaro is the consulting editor at The Rail and the Burchard Professor of Art History and Director of Hunter College Galleries, and the author of several books. He has also been the curator at MoMA's Department of Painting and Sculpture, as well as Gagosian Gallery in London. Artist, writer, and performer Constance DeJong is well known for her contributions to downtown New York's performance art and media art scene of the 70s and 80s, and is considered one of the progenitors of media art or time-based media. She has also worked for over three decades on narrative form within the context of avant-garde music and contemporary art. And now I'll hand it off to Joachim to kick it off.
Thank you, Catherine. Thank you for these very moving words. And I'm very glad that the Rail has decided to introduce its programs by this moment of silence in recognition of the appalling situation that has been unfolding for too long. Thank you. Constance, if I may, I'd followed your work for decades, literally, and I would like to start about how, in a way, we came into contact, not virtually but physically, together at Hunter College. I was not yet hired as a professor in, I think, 2005, 2006. I forget the exact date, but I did come across your work. Not so much as an artist in this particular instance, but as a curator. And not many people know how what an extraordinary feat, curatorially speaking, you put together. And you know what I'm about to talk about by this exhibition that you put together in the Hunter Galleries in around 2006. And that was a kind of summation of the pioneering beginnings of the new work done by this completely new medium in the mid 1960s or early 70s, the portable video. Would you like to take us through that that itinerary, that conception that you put together, and that was a mind and eye-opening experience as far as I was concerned?
Oh, thank you for remembering it, Joachim. Hunter has two galleries. One is in the building at 68th and Lexington, called Lupsdorf Gallery. And I had been teaching at Hunter as a visiting artist. And the chairperson at the time, who was very active in originally forming the gallery, invited me to submit a proposal to the gallery committee. And that was interesting. Asked an artist to think of an exhibition. I gave it thought. I rejected a few ideas, and was interested in having an exhibition of the first visual artist to use the first visual, portable video equipment, which it's argued exactly what year did that equipment come to the United States, basically 1969. It's called the Sony Portapack. Previously, video equipment was a behemoth that could only be in a television studio, you know, sort of like a tractor, you drive it around. Sony Portapack, technology became an instrument artists could take into their studios and work with just as they would other materials and mediums, you know, studio practice. A very big event in a long history of making art that in the hands of individual artists, there was the wherewithal to make time-based work. So I knew that history rather well. Some of it predates me, most of it does, but I knew it very well. I'd been interested in time-based work my whole life. So that was my idea. And because of a rather limited budget, I could only address the first artist to use that work in New York. I couldn't go to Yugoslavia, I couldn't include the Yugoslavian artists and even the West Coast artists. And I don't remember the number. I was afraid you were going to ask me this, so I have the list of the artists in the show.
I was about to say, this didn't feel like a limitation at all. I mean, I did not know that you had decided for budgetary reasons to focus on New York artists only, but it was so rich and so all-encompassing. And I remember you saying to me, and that was very touching as well, that, I mean, that's curatorially, it's almost an impossibility, then a dream come true. But you had asked a number of artists, probably about 15, 20 artists, I think, in your list, and everybody accepted to lend their work, is that correct?
That's correct. They were...
That's unheard of.
Yeah, they were generous to a person. That included submitting to each of them to an interview, because I had a notion that rather than have a lot of essays in the book or have me write some, you know, overview of the subject of the exhibition, that it would be more interesting for each artist to be represented in their own voice in the catalogs. Mm-hmm. Each of them submitted to an interview. I took the interview and transcribed it, and I took out me asking the questions, and so you only get the answers, and I turned it into a kind of a flow as if they're just talking. But that was very generous of people also. To give that time. Oh, and they also, on request, they get ephemera, because there was a large collection of ephemera from this time, 1969 to 1979, included in the exhibition. So people went into their archives and gave treasure, real treasure, in addition to
it was absolutely extraordinary exhibition. And so taking us from your beginnings, as it were, at Hunter to yesterday, to today, I would like to bring up another publication. That is the publication that you put together with Sarah Watson, with Jocelyn Spahr, with our other colleagues. And I'd like also to mention Liz Edger and her father, John, who has been extraordinarily generous to enable this to be put together. And that is, I can barely show it on the camera, but this is a brochure, a catalog that beats, that breaks all boundaries, all definitions. It looks more like an accordion or like a musical instrument. You can look at it from one end or the other. There is no beginning, no end. It's a sort of circular concept. So do you want to take us a little bit through this this extraordinary creation? And I really can't tell you, I just received it by the way yesterday. So I have a little bit that silence, so the child surprise first reaction, but I'm just cherishing it, no end.
Thrilled to hear you say that, and not many people have received it. Just by way of a wee bit of context, we made a publication on the occasion of an exhibition that was summarily shut down the week of the New York City shutdown, just some days before our opening. I took the occasion of an exhibition to once again go in, address, and think about what can a publication be. I don't want to be a curmudgeon and say all catalogs suck or anything like that, categorical. But there are paradigms for catalogs that tend to be text occupies one part of the page, pictures, images are another part with their captions, and there's certain professionals are invited to write overview, one or two essays. Is that fair, Joachim, as a description?
Absolutely, very fair.
Because I think so much about the page as a site and what a publication can be, I set about rethinking what a publication for an exhibition could be. So in terms of the design, I wanted, it looks just like a codex. Can people see this?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's just, you know, a codex. It opens. It's, you know, pages that are bound. But then there happens to be, oh, you turn it another way. And there's another book that's the same thing, a codex of pages. The two parts, to my mind, are very different. The front, what might be, to me, considered the front was, I don't have survey shows all the time. And I wasn't interested in a summation of my life. It kind of gave me the creeps, or my life's work, or, you know. So I thought of having a bouquet of texts be in the publication. So 10 people from very different professions and vocations were asked to write no more than 1,000 words about one work or one form. Not an overview, in other words, even though that occasionally happened. So, and I asked what are sometimes considered unlikely people. I'll just stop talking in a minute. The first contribution written by the preparator at the Renaissance Society. And he's a genius of audio. And as some of you know, I work a lot with audio. This is a waveform of my voice speaking. And it's unlikely he would be asked to be a contributor to a catalog. He's a preparator, but he's an audio genius. I work very closely with him. I learned, you know, we shared what we knew with each other. And he was absolutely a great person to ask. He wrote very interestingly. So a preparator, Lucy Ives is a fiction writer who sometimes writes about other authors. And I'll just do the first three. This is fellow artist Tony Auersler writing about my radios. So I wanted this bouquet that would, each of the 10 people are addressing something specific. They're not just all of me. And then each contributor has a double page spread, and I designed how to integrate image and text in different ways again and again. Yeah. This is a favorite of people's.
So I love the fact that you have come up with this this metaphor of the bouquet. Before, as I was starting to think about what we were going to say today at the rail, it struck me that you are, and correct me if you disagree or if you think I'm wrong, but you are one of these artists who transcend definitions, media. You just talked about how your approach to this catalog, which is so completely out there, totally different from anything I've seen, where there's no beginning nor no end, or perhaps the end point is the middle of the book where those two creatures meet together. And I was thinking that you touch also all senses. You look, your approach to the text, you're a great writer, poet, and your text is not a set unit, a solid static object. You turn the text into a movable thing, into a time-based object. And I just want to go back to this metaphor you threw in here, that of the bouquet, because I thought maybe the only sense that Constance is not activating is the olfactive sense, the smell. But in fact, you just talked about a bouquet of text, and that suggests itself a kind of poetical, all senses combined type of approach. So I don't know if you agree with that. And I know you're a great reader of one of my favorite authors, Gaston Bachelard, who you quote in the text as well, a beautiful passage on fire. So I'd like to ask you about that. There's the word synesthesia, there's this multiple sensory activation resonate with you, or am I, is it just me?
Yeah, in my best dreams, especially the synesthesia part. I mean, you struck on something that has always mattered to me from early on when I was just trying to make work. My sort of understanding of language and my relation to language was that it was time-based. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I mean that in very importantly. As some of you know, I do my share of spoken language, but the spoken language and the written language have a relationship. It's not my spoken language work that made me aware of language as time-based, by which I mean print language. What is this? What is doing this? Mm-hmm. If it's not time-based? What is one sentence? One word follows another word. A line follows another line. The paragraph, it's sequential. It's a succession. It's occupying time interiorly as well, you know, as well as physically. So, so you mentioned that, and yeah, that really matters to me, and still matters to me, and is a force when I'm writing a new thing, even now. You know, it's a real consideration. Synesthesia would be, if I could evoke synesthesia in people in relation to my work, I would be thrilled. I would be thrilled to evoke synesthesia experiences, color and smell.
What I find fascinating in looking at your work over and over is that you have us readers, because the text is, it seems to me, the nexus to which you return, and to you return us as well. But you unpack out of the notion of the text that we have, and that we kind of fetishize in a way as a solid unit, to open it up almost like a Pandora's box and create out of, have us return to it through the visual, through the sonorous, through the moving, through the this almost a cinematographic and again multifarious sensorious aspect. If I may, if you allow me, we have a very dear friend in the person of Daniel Boshkov, who's one of our colleagues at Hunter, a great artist as well. And he and I were talking about your work, and I would like to read a passage that Daniel brought in thinking about your work. And he's quoting himself, Barthes, one of my favorite texts as well, Lover's Discourse, Fragment d'un discours amoureux. And I just quote, this is Daniel Boshkov quoting Barthes, thinking about Constance de Jong, okay? Language is a skin. I rub my language against the other. It is as if I had words instead of fingers, or fingers at the tip of my words. George, can you turn off this radio? I'm on a public discussion. It is as if I had words instead of fingers, or fingers at the tip of my words. End of quote. So I just I want to salute Daniel here. I think he's probably listening to us. And I just say this is another great artist, Barthes, and thinker, like you. Came into the notion of language, of semiotext, and so on, but through his sense, or through his body, in a way. And I feel that that's very consonant with your approach of the text. I don't know if you agree.
No, I do agree. And there are people of language who jump out. At least to me, they jump out, you know, over history, whose engagement with languages, it's very particular, it's very investigated, it's very thoughtful. Now those sound like, of course, anybody working with language does that. So it's a rather hard thing to talk about, but for some people of language, it's a medium, you know, it's a mutable and malleable medium, if you will. It's not just a delivery system for action or events or ideas, you know. It's not just an invisible, like on the page, if it's on the page, it's not just an invisible delivery system, you know. And Roland Barthes is special, you know, among, as a person of language, this kind of form that he invented, that it's a kind of critique, it's a kind of nonfiction that is very lyrical, and you know, he invented, Borges did that. What the heck are those, is Borges's form, that short form where nonfiction and fiction have a porosity. Those mm-hmm. people of language jump out for whom the malleability of language is such that a form emerges from their work. Mm-hmm.
This is not the first time I've heard you use that term, which I love, and especially in relationship to your own creation, Constance, and that's the term porosity. It is as though one form, one medium, one sense, one set of senses corresponds to the other, to use a Baudelairean term, to open to each other, so that there is no staunch, no there is a differentiation, but there's no watertight separation between those different forms, different media. Does that characterize what you're doing? Would you say?
Yes. Yes, I would. I don't know. Is it the fault of the Enlightenment or what, that we became category makers?
Yeah.
Assigners of names for things. Sorry. Go ahead.
No, you're absolutely right. It does start with the Enlightenment, with the German Romantics, who start establishing, with the Laocoon text, that separation of media is what should be done, and it just runs through the entire spectrum of 200 years into modernism, and you break this up, break this apart in a way.
The binaries are tiresome. I mean, a really obvious one, and many people agree, disagree, is fiction, nonfiction. Mm-hmm. This strict border that was made between what those things are, what those categories mean, and therefore what content and what subject matter can be. And then in terms of form, the porosity for me, to an extent, has to do with language itself, which is that language, or my interest, I should say, from the get-go, was what could language do? Where could it be? What form could it take? Where could it operate? Where could it perform? So the very first work I did was a print book, a series of live performances with pre-recorded video and audio, and a one-hour audio work. And that's a kind of porosity, because the language that was written reshapes, and I make it specific to the next form or the other form. I reshape a bit an entire book so that it takes up 1 hour of audio space. Mm-hmm. In live performance, the written language becomes spoken language. And I learned how to do that. If that answers what you're asking about.
I'm thinking, totally. I'm thinking that perhaps for the benefit of our audience, we should maybe give an example of what you're talking about. But perhaps, since I have this text, this incredible catalog in front of me, and this image also of one of your works, based on fire, another form of media, I'd like to read what you just wrote, which I absolutely love, and that's, enter Gaston Bachelard, pondering fire in 1938. He says, "We are almost certain that fire is precisely the first object, the first phenomenon on which the human mind reflected. Among all phenomena, fire alone is sufficiently prized by prehistoric man to wake in him the desire for knowledge, and this mainly because it accompanies the desire for love." And so here comes Constance DeJong commenting on Bachelard: "The desire for knowledge accompanies the desire for love." Knowledge, love, another form of porosity here. And you say, quite the claim, published in the year 1938. And you go on about the terrible historical moment of 1938. But I love this other combination you established via Bachelard between knowledge and love, things, two sets of activities, human activities that are almost never brought in together. But that's very, very powerful in my eyes.
On that text, just to sort of reinforce that I'm not blowing smoke previously, that text goes on, quite the claim, Knowledge and Love in 1938. Then it named Hitler in 1938, Mussolini in 1938, etc. What the moment of 1938 was. So
yeah.
That fiction, nonfiction that I was talking about, the porosity between, I'm actually writing a fiction piece there, and it is a fiction, but it has space for pieces of the world to come in. It sounds, it may sound horrid and pretentious, but the work, I'm not a storyteller, per se, a conventional storyteller. You know, you make up characters and you have them do things and they have a certain color of hair and they look, you know, that. And there's an event or series of events that happen and we call it a story. Now, of course, it's a very expansive idea. Many ideas make a story, but I'm not, to myself, I am not a storyteller. I'm a vastly, and for my entire life, invested in, curious about, maybe obsessed with narrative and what is narrative, and what can narrative be and do. So the engines of narrative for me are less stories about people, although that comes in, stories about these characters I invent, then it comes from a world of ideas and a world of events and a world that has occurred, if you will, and that some of which I haven't even existed in. 1938 predates me. But 1938, through the war and the horrible despots of the time, and then through Bachelard, is in my life.
Right.
Because timelines run, you know, in long duration, short durations, and they combine in a person. So and I became slightly obsessed. I mean, it's gonna make me sound like an idiot, but I started writing about fire and candlelight. And And there are interesting aspects of it. I don't want to go on, but Bachelard, many artists know Bachelard through a text that for a while was kind of in the canon called The Poetics of Space. He also wrote a very small book called The Psychoanalysis of Fire. What the heck?
Yes.
He's a very interesting thinker. I had already isolated and located candlelight as a space for contemplation. You know, when you go interior, you know, you look at fire and you daydream, you remember, you know, it's a very commonly experienced phenomenon, staring at fire and thinking.
Beautiful. Maybe could we perhaps show one example? I know that you have a few examples to the audience. That we see, we hear, we experience. Yeah, great. Thank you. So this is one of your texts where what I was referring to earlier on, the text becomes this. You have the text return to its essence as a sequential entity, but we tend to forget that. And you have us, apply upon it its own sonorous, its own visual, auditory, sensitive, sensorial essence as it is being performed, right?
Yes.
And those waves are the waves of your own voice. Can you tell us a little bit?
Yes. In maybe 2015, or so, it doesn't matter. I started writing some work small in scale that were only meant to be spoken either in performance or to become audio works recorded and to live in these re-engineered radio objects that I was making. And I was both performing and showing the radios, and people started asking me if they could print the text of the work, as if the text was this freestanding thing. The text was not freestanding. When I spoke it in performance, it had other audio elements of it. When it was recorded, spoken text was a part of other audio elements. And that is represented visually here. And I went a little further than that. I can't point, but people who recognize a waveform will know that the text that's being spoken is there in English language, and along with it is the waveform. And because the text speaks about insomnia, and because I perform live, I also included waveforms of my sleep patterns. And which, you know, is the brain, as it were, I just also took the waveform patterns of like when you get I'm struggling. I can't remember what it's called when you get it. Is it an EKG?
EKG.
Yeah. EKG. So it's my heart when I'm performing, it's my brain in sleep, it's my voice in the, and it's an imaging of the piece, which is an audio work.
Wow, yeah. And I love the fact that one of the themes that resonates here is those of candles, again, fire and flowers. These two candles and flowers returning through this text.
Yeah, this is a light box that I printed on vellum. I transferred the waveforms also onto the vellum. I had to hand draw some of them. And the vellum is in a light box so that the transparency, it kind of vivifies this image, if you will, through the light and the transparency. So that's what.
I'm sure many
Emily, isn't there of what I call a transcription? If you're interested. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So could we see one of the other transcriptions, perhaps? Hello?
Yep.
So these are combination of methods to produce them. But not the same features are at work. This is one of the first ones I did. So the waveforms are my spoken voice, and then I put in all the Foley and sound material exactly where it is in the audio work, so that the text continuously is all the material at once happening, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And this is a long, and then I printed it on nice paper, and it's a 42-inch scroll. And the 42 inches of the transcription are in real time, something like 4.5 minutes. That's the length of the audio work. I should say, if I might, Joachim, do you know that I don't qualify as a visual artist, but artists have used language visually. You know, of course they have. And just to make some contact, you know, Jenny Holzer, mm-hmm. how Joseph Kosuth did and still, you know, does treats language as a visual component of, right. you know, two-dimensional work. Lawrence Wiener, mm-hmm. Jenny and I belong more or less to you know, the same period of time, and lived in the same neighborhood on the Lower East Side, and her first work were really sort of like wheat paste aphorisms on the walls and the street lamps. But I'm just bringing in context. There was a moment when language kind of became the material of visual artists.
But you've embraced a number of side, equipment in a way, related to language or that have to do with language that are not often used, like a radio. You have a fascination for the radio in many, many ways. You might want to get into this. And I would also like to talk about another aspect of your work also that has to do with language, which is your interest in opera, and many members of the audience, I'm sure, will have heard about your collaboration with Philip Glass in 1980, was it, over this, as a librettist for the opera that you co-signed. So let's start with the radio. Sorry.
What? The radio, since we're kind of in this realm of what does a woman do with language? There's a group of images that we can see, Emily, that are radio based.
And we will see some of the radios if you keep going.
Well, this is.
Yeah, there's so much.
We missed it. Can you just go to the radios without?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, here's one.
Don't play it yet, please. I have, radio is an old love, a very old love. You know, I was a preteen, you know, I was the child who went to bed with a portable radio on my pillow. And I would stay awake so that I could dial in other time zones. I was in Northern Ohio, and I would dial in Chicago at midnight. And there was this amazing radio personality named Wolfman coming to you from Chicago. And I still appreciate this very intimate relationship between a person and the disengaged voice, the disembodied, not disengaged, the disembodied voice. You're there. Right. Disembodied voice. It's a very special form of engagement with something. A wee bit analogous to reading. They're both very asocial. It's you as a single being connected to another being. So my it's very old, and I love that intimacy about the radio. And early on, I made a work for radio out from the first book that I made public, and so it goes back. And then a colleague and friend over many years reminded me again and again and again of my love of radio, and why didn't I re-engage with that love. So around 2015, I imagined what I could do. And I knew enough about electronics that I knew one could re-engineer vintage radios, and with SD cards and programming and Arduinos and all kinds of electronic, contemporary electronics, that I could program vintage radios with, most of them have between 30 to 50 minutes of material on them. At first I didn't know anything about vintage radios. So I just would go into a junk store, and I found this in a junk store. It's a pink General Electric. It's probably from early 60s from the look of it. And it was the first one that was re-engineered. If you could play it, but there's just a few seconds of material.
My blackout ends with golden light, inches from my eyes, a small caliber bullet, boxing gloves, three names spelled out in diamond accented gold script, and two obscure symbols. Introduce my hospital orderly, Charles Baker, his autobiography dangling from his neck.
I don't know if that audio is very clear. Is there a way that you can dial it with audio in like you did the other day, Catherine?
Just one moment.
Yeah, I always work like this presents a little technical problem. So anyway, for those of you who are with us, there's a way that you can just go to the computer speakers so that the volume is as clear and as loud as it can be, right? I don't know if we can do that.
Can we try again?
Yeah, just one moment.
That radio and a series of the first radios are, as I said, spoken word text, musical material, Foley, it's called Foley material, although I don't use Foley in a representational way. And each track is anywhere from, I would say, 5 to 12 minutes, and every radio has 5 to 7 pieces on it, tracks on it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Track is an actual complete audio work. What the little excerpt that maybe we can hear is, there's a wonderful actor in New York City, Jim Fletcher. He has worked with Richard Maxwell, with Performance Garage, really accomplished actor and very accomplished at delivering language. And I asked him to record some of the works for the first radios. And so that's Jim Fletcher's voice on this radio.
My blackout ends with golden things inches from my eyes, a small caliber bullet, boxing gloves, three names spelled out in diamond-accented gold script, and two obscure symbols introduce my hospital orderly, Charles Baker, his autobiography dangling from his neck.
So it's just a tiny snippet I always wanted to write the biography of an object, and so I used jewelry, which sometimes jewelry has a long life. It's given to other people, it ends up in an auction, somebody else buys it. So that piece is about the biography of jewelry. And I love it for a man to be reading it. He's just so full-throatedly evokes subject of jewelry. I don't know if you want to see the other radio that...
Yes, I think we should look at the other radio because it is such a beautiful object as well. Racetrack? What is it called?
Over time.
Zenith Racetrack. Yeah.
Zenith Racetrack. Over time, well, sort of right away, after I started going in junk stores and finding these old radios, and then I started going online, and this is an entire world of collectibles and collecting vintage radios, and there's a whole history of their design by named designers. This is a very good and prolific designer's work. His name is Mercurio, Fred Mercurio, who designed, this is colloquially named the Zenith racetrack for this shape that he made. And it's a very, I didn't know this. I didn't, wasn't becoming a collector of vintage radios. I was, you know, appropriating them as a form. But I did learn a lot about them, and I came to look upon them analogously to cars. It was the only other object I could think of where season after season, the new models came out, you know, and where a domestic object and appliance got so much design poured into it.
I was wondering, the only other artist I can think of who has such an engagement with the radio as an object and as a source of text and sound is John Cage, who wrote a composition called Imaginary Landscape Number 4, I mean, which is entirely written for radios. You're aware of that? You know this piece?
I became aware of it. Yes, I tried to become aware of everyone who might have worked with radio, and so I came upon that. Yes, Georges Perec wrote and worked with radio also, and so did Kurt Schwitters.
Ah, yes, Schwitters.
Just a small handful of radiophiles artists.
Yes, radiophiles, a new word that could be the subject of an entire show, I suppose, right?
I should mention, we're going to play this, and this is a still of the radio, and I attached an audio soundtrack to it that comes from the radio. But I should mention that I worked with a really gifted person who we all want to be close to if the apocalypse comes, because he can rebuild the universe. He can code, he knows electronics, he can physically build. There are, you know, he's made many theremins. He can make anything, let's say. So he was my right hand to what I'm calling engineering, the re-engineering of these radios. And I had this idea to put LED lights behind the face of the radio. And he ended up connecting the LED lights to respond to the frequency of the voice that was speaking. So they flutter with, it's not that they're going on and off like this, but they flutter with fluctuation of the frequency of the voice. It's a very lovely effect. The Z at the top of that radio is cut out, and behind it is a wash of pink LED light that fluctuates to the voice.
Wow. Oh, amazing.
Huh. And yeah, Charlie Hobbs is his name. Very, very accomplished person. Maybe we play it? And I'll drink some tea.
Sorry,
I
couldn't hear what you just...
I think you should pull it back to zero. Seem to jump forward. Thank you.
The wavelengths, vagrant messages in the air you're walking through. People have long believed sound waves once made are ever present. Tonight, you just go around with an earworm is all you hear. Sorrowful is playing on the bandwidth in your head. 1,001, 2, up to 4,057 steps you've walked. 1 mile west, nearly 1 mile north. These four candles and some flowers on a patch of sidewalk. One of, you can't count how many vigils there've been this year. Alicia Walker, your upstairs neighbor, is four candles and some flowers on a patch of sidewalk. Alicia, one of, you can't count how many vigils there've been this year. All the gunned-down souls always seem to begin with all the gunned-down souls in Mississippi, Chicago, Kent State, Akron, Dallas, Atlanta, always in the air you're walking through. Slow it down now. Always in the air you're walking through. If you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. If you have an answer for everything, you're not asking the right questions. In 800 steps, in 400 steps, slow it down. In 200 steps, you'll be home.
And, there's I was just looking at a text in the catalog by our colleague Jocelyn Spar, who refers to the manifold frequencies of Constance DeJong. I think it's a beautiful title. It's a great text, and you should look at it if you would like. I think we would be not doing well. It's impossible to do justice to the manifold frequencies of your work, Constance, in an hour, but we would certainly, I think, go, we would be remiss, I think, if we did not at least allude to an aspect of your work that is so grand as well, and that is you as a librettist and your cooperation with Philip Glass over this amazing opera. And do we have a small excerpt that perhaps we could play to the audience, and would you like to take us through this, and perhaps after this, Catherine, we could have questions?
This is a, for all of us watching, this is just a 1 minute, 47 second compilation introduction to the opera we did in the 1980 was its premiere time. The name of the opera is Satyagraha, and I can talk about it. I know we're running out of time, but let's just play it.
Timeliness of this today is very moving, I find. But what an amazing opera, which for the audience is, I actually learned recently from Constance that it is on the repertoire of the Metropolitan Opera, and it was performed again in 2008, as you see. So, yeah, 12 years ago. It feels like it was a few months ago, but it's such a powerful, incredible work. Sorry, Constance.
No. I'm sorry. I just really briefly, the content of Satyagraha is the first large-scale practice of nonviolent civil disobedience, which was conducted between 1893-1914, the years Gandhi was in South Africa and the Indians living in South Africa were subjected to a color bar in the same way that the Africans themselves were. And so the opera is, it maps the history of an idea for me, the idea of being nonviolent civil disobedience, the derivation of which Gandhi finds in a classic Indian text, the Bhagavad Gita, and he develops it into a resistance movement in South Africa. He gains contemporaries, Tolstoy and Rabindranath Tagore, who became supporters and writers of the idea of nonviolent civil disobedience. And the final act is those dark shadow figures that you saw. The entire third act of the opera is witnessed by Martin Luther King Jr. and those shadow figures enact the treatment of African Americans and civil rights workers by the police. And so it ends with if it's the history of the idea of nonviolent civil disobedience, it ends with Martin Luther King Jr. being the inheritor of that practice and practicing it in the United States. Mm-hmm. That's the concept of the opera. Unfortunately, that content has a kind of bad relevancy again and again. Yeah.
I was about to say this is a perfect and at the same time scary way to conclude about these remarks, but it is incredible how vividly resonant with what we're seeing today this opera is, and the practice of Gandhi, which I think is not sufficiently known, but so it's incredible work. I would really encourage anyone to try to look back at this performance. Catherine, do you think we should perhaps open up to questions?
Well, if you guys want to keep talking for a few more minutes about Satyagraha or some of the other videos, we're starting to have a few questions. Just a reminder, if people want to ask questions, Constance and Joachim, you can drop those in the chat. So if you guys just want to spend a few more minutes talking, that's okay.
Well, perfect. Thank you. You know, we can go on with Constance. There's no tears of material and topics. What Satyagraha, what does it mean? Can you remind us, Constance?
It's a Sanskrit word. One of Gandhi's acts of resistance was to insist on insist that the resistance movement use their own language. They did not use the Afrikaner's language when they were meeting, when they were publishing, and when they were when he was naming the resistance, Satyagraha, which is this, translated in Sanskrit is truth force.
Truth force.
We say speaking truth to power now. It's that's what it means. And just one maybe last comment on the opera. It's about a resistance and a movement. So in a way, although the figure of Gandhi matters, in a way the main character of the opera is the people who collectively are the resistance. Now in opera, rather snobbishly, the chorus is the background, and in this opera the chorus becomes the foreground main character because of the content being about resistance. And I think some of the most moving, eloquent, and gorgeous music Philip Glass ever wrote are the scenes in this opera where the chorus is the character and is vocalizing and singing acts of resistance. It's very good.
I was about to say the music itself is so taking, so really gripping. difficult.
It's early in his career, really.
Sorry, Constance?
It's a bit early in his career, if you mm-hmm. think that he's now whatever he is. It has a, you know, the orchestra that plays it is a not a classic symphony or opera orchestra. There's no brass. There's no percussion. There's keyboard. Mm-hmm. It's called a Baroque orchestra. It's much lighter. It's wind instrument, string and keyboard.
Very impressive. Yeah. So, what we could perhaps say a few. Sorry.
The best president. Catherine suggested we show something else. Maybe we just show the benches or the talking photograph or something.
Ah, yeah. Absolutely, that would be amazing. So those benches. Was the first one you did the one that this? In Beacon, Constance? Sorry, I should just let the sound.
Oh, well, maybe shall we just play it? Or do you want me to?
Let's look at it first. Let's look and listen to it. Speaking of the river. Thanks.
When you are not here, nocturnal animals are in the open, somewhere you are not. When you are not here, a nightbird stands sentinel in a tree. When you are not here, the number 6 is everywhere. Every snowflake formed of 6 points, 6 axes, the flakes falling to a depth of 3 feet. Very quiet when you are not here.
River's very quiet today.
It's also a very dangerous, very fast flowing river.
Oh look, there's a liner.
Very dangerous.
That river's very quiet today. And it was very quiet. There was nothing there.
And you could see quite clearly that the water has a calming effect.
And that's when it can be very cruel, very cruel.
Just a tiny excerpt.
So for the audience, it's important to understand that what we are actually looking at, right? You have a public bench, which has one or two speakers, right? That are activated anytime a bypasser sits on it and activates the sensor that starts the emission of the sound, right?
Right. Exactly. Yes. The metal one is, if you remember the metal one, that's along the Thames at Canary Wharf in London. That first one that's made of a kind of very smooth cement. I worked with a designer, we designed it. I made the benches to fit into their location and to not be themselves something to look at, as you know, although I was very devoted to what they looked at like and made them very carefully. And they use an infrared sensor so that when a person sits down, it activates the audio, and the audio is such that each moment is somewhere from 1 to 2.5, 3 minutes, and there's just a tiny break and another one and another one and another one, so that if you're a very zen-like person, you might sit there for the entire 15 minutes, unlikely. If you're a regular visitor to that site, it means that you can go and you can revisit the bench many times, because you will never, every time it plays, it played in a different order, so you would hear a different work. And in the interest of not being detested by people who were in these locations, I always made a nearby bench that didn't have any sound on it. If you just wanted to sit down and look at the Hudson of the Thames.
I did not know the detail, Constance, but it brings to mind something that I find very interesting and very lovable about your approach to sound. Because any curator of video or sound animated works knows the difficulty of putting together different sound-based performances, installations, where the sound bleeds out. It becomes inevitably something like a cacophony, or it becomes very difficult to actually concentrate on one given piece. And you are super aware of that, Constance, if I may say so. And there's a delicacy in your approach to sound, that a delicatesse, elegance, in fact. You're very aware of the fact that one viewer, one listener is engaged with a particular sound piece. And you have created these silos. You can explain, you know what I'm talking about, and maybe you can explain better than I, the fact that the source of sound is really designed for one particular receptor, one particular person at a time. I find this very touching, yeah. In fact.
I used the word intimacy before in terms of
intimacy.
How I relate to the disembodied voice or to an audio moment. And I think I've evoked or provoked intimate works, if you will, or a kind of intimacy through the work. I've used sensors a lot. If the works are indoors, a proximity sensor, your body triggers the work. I will not have audio works blurring into space nonstop. Whether right. Outdoors or indoors. So I can't think of a work that I've made that doesn't involve sensors, so that mm-hmm. when it's mm-hmm. placed, whether it's indoors or outdoors, you initiate the work, if you will, and yeah. then it's your work. Audio are differently a bit from looking at moving images. Not to get too nerdy, but audio is very interior. It goes through our frequencies, go through this hole in our head, these holes mm-hmm. in our head, yeah. and enter us. Yeah, there is an interiority to audio per se and sound per se that is also part of what I think about and what I work with. Just a last note on that, I in various sites where I made these, I call them affectionately talking benches. I talked with and interviewed and recorded conversations with locals for whom the site was very, very a part of their life. And they are on the benches as well. And they sometimes perform a text that I wrote, and then I edit that with things they said in conversation. So that the public is represented on the bench. It's not just my voice.
Hmm. It's a sort of circular performance in a way. It starts with the public, ends with the public, you as a teacher.
It mattered to me, that.
And that's, perhaps I think Catherine has a few questions, but I'd like just to add one word. You mentioned intimacy, which is, in a way, it's counterintuitive to most artists who do work with sound, even though I love what you're saying about the fact that you interiorize or you privatize, in a way, the sound experience and make it something very, very personal, very deep inside. But it's, in fact, you're one of the only artists I know who does approach sound this way. I find it, there's a sense of respect, a respectful dimension to your work that I find very admirable. Thank you. Catherine, did you say that you had a few questions?
Yeah, we have a couple of questions in the chat. The first question actually comes from our poet today, Uche. I'll pass the mic to you. You should be able to activate your mic now.
All right. Yeah, good. So the question is for Constance. Thanks for sharing your processes. Sometimes some artists are very, very shy or cagey, rather, about their working processes. But what I wanted to ask directly is about, it has to do with language. As I said, I asked, why is language seemingly central in your work while you still insist that you are not a storyteller?
Allow me to go speechless in response to your question. There are things I understand about what I do and things I don't understand.
Good.
Yeah, absolutely. And my attraction to obsession with language is something I can't explicate. I can't articulate what that fit is.
Okay.
I would go so far as to say it's lifelong. It's not just something in my adult life. You know, I discovered the bookmobile in libraries when I was 7 or 8 years old and I was home, you know. And I'm ever fascinated with language, that's all I can say. I get into trouble with saying not storyteller. I will try to not be too offensive here, because in a sense what I mean by that is a formulaic and conventional notion that has been forwarded by publishing and other systems and vehicles, television, cinema, this thing, the damn story with its arc. You know, people, about that. So my objection is to that, if you will, or my not lack of interest in it, if not objection, you know. And at the same time, this prison house of language being successive and consecutive and the word follows and so on, I don't detest. I love it and I love to engage with it. And so I choose to say narrative instead of story. And narrative can be composed and shaped and not fit that convention of story. Yes. Does that make sense?
Yes, what I hear actually for me, what I'm trying to perhaps get you to say is simply that your work is non-linear. Yeah.
I refuse to say that. Yes. But you can say it.
It's non-linear. You know, you're still trying to put in some message out there, but it's not in the way that people will expect it. And I love that. Actually, I do that a lot in my own work too. That's part of why I just wanted to almost like joke about it. People at times insist a story has to have a beginning, a middle, and an end. Yeah. You know, all those sort of, I call them boring processes of narrative. What I see your work doing, which I find very fascinating about it, is that you smash these codes, these official codes of language. And that actually forces the viewer or the reader to pay more closer attention to it. If the story flows more easily, people are lazy, either. They almost close their eyes and think you are taking them for a ride or whatever. But when you have to peep at, is this phrase completed or is it not completed yet? And all that, it actually elicits attention. Yeah. And I like that, must say.
You know, thank you. You bring up something that is a, I don't know if I would call it a bias in me, but I'll call it a bias in me. I find the act of reading, listening, and you know, very engaging. And I want to be engaged. I want to know that I'm reading. I'm not talking about my other people. I want to know that I'm reading. I want to have to read that. I don't know that damn language. Oh my God, how, you know, that whole experience, or same with something I'm hearing or looking at. Without that, you know, without that, who cares? So I think I know what you mean, because as a viewer and a consumer and a reader, I'm that way. I want that, you know.
Thank you so much for your answer. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Uche, for that. Our next question comes from one of our regulars, Justin. I will pass the mic to you. You should be able to talk.
Thanks. Well, it's kind of funny because the question that I have is about the exhibition you did with Philip Orchid of Corsair at the McAvoy Foundation of Arts. It's called Stories. I was kind of wondering, say what?
And them.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the exhibition and maybe just how the work with the radios sort of interacted with images, or, you know, if how maybe you saw that work reinterpreted in that manner or not.
Sure, yeah. For fear of sounding a bit like an idiot, when I was making the radios and thinking about them conceptually, and not to harp on this, but this intimacy, you know, between a viewer or a listener and the radio, when I finished them and, then how do they live in an exhibition space? Me with this concern of things just blaring, you know, into the space. So it brought in the next stage of sort of making a place for the radios to be and for you to be with them. And Kevin Moore, who was the McAvoy curator, and in put that show together, understood that, and with the exhibiting site, I was able to have situations built, a little furniture, a place, you know, so that you could sit with the work. The integration with those really, you know, that great photography work was the institutions and the curators' perspective. They put that together, and specifically Kevin did, and they used the word stories. And I wish he was, Kevin, if you're there, please yell. I just let it be, Justin. I found my way through the juxtaposition myself, and I didn't know the photography for work very well, so I was in that phase of also just learning it. McAvoy is a very big space, so these large sort of contemplative photographs and the small radios, they lived very beautifully together. Did you happen to see it?
Justin? I didn't see it, but I had seen images of the show because I like Philip Lorcan, of course, his photo work, and so I had seen that exhibition and sort of at the time was more looking at that, and now sort of re-looking at it with your work sort of centered in my imagination. It kind of changes the relationship between the images and the audio sort of that's happening there, and thinking about the sequentiality of those images, or, you know, maybe what you're hearing in the background potentially near those spaces, or
It's so vast. The McAvoy's exhibiting space, you know, is so vast that thing that I would rather not have happen with the sound just pouring, you know, into the space, didn't do that cacophony phenomenon. So there was respect and space for Philip's. They claimed space, if you will, and the radios were far enough away. I was lucky. That was a really interesting exhibition, and it happened that the curator of the Renaissance Society was in San Francisco, saw that exhibition, then she made a group exhibition with four artists and put together another one of these very interesting, not thematic, you know, not a not a group show that was grinding some axe, just really interesting relationships between works. And curators can do that, you know that, Justin, that you figure out why this work is together. It's not just straight up obvious. Mm-hmm. And that show at McAvoy was like that. To the curator's credit.
Thank you, Justin, for that question. Our next question comes from Jonathan Zimmerman, which I will read aloud for him. And the question is this. The radio works seem to present an intersection of the individual narrative, the individual intimacy of experience with the mass-produced product object. Are these artworks available as multiples for a larger audience or just unique objects for an individual intimate experience? And he just wanted to add that he's reflecting on the readings from Benjamin and Warhol.
They're small additions, Jonathan. I'm hesitating because I'm trying to count in my head how many I made, and I'm sorry, I can't remember. I was kind of working in series. So I made a first series and second and third and fourth. There's probably together maybe 35 or 40 radios. And so they end up being, you know, standalone objects that are the place for an hour's worth of audio work. A kind of a strange hybrid object. That's not quite an addition. I hope that answers clearly. Post another question, Jonathan, if I'm stammering and not answering.
I'll be on the lookout for his response. Our final question, which I will also read aloud, comes from David Carrier. And he wanted to know if you could just discuss the charm of obsolete technologies like the radios you were showing earlier.
What's the question, the name of, who's asking?
David Carrier.
David. Maybe you find it obsolete technology charming. I discovered in starting to work with these vintage radios how much attention people were paying to what they looked like, which my head was, you know, in the material itself a bit more than that. And as I think I said a little bit previously, and to repeat, my love of radio enlarged into a love of the physical object itself, you know, and I went on these absurd hunts for the vintage radio. My first love of obsolete technology referring to radio was once upon a time, very early on, radios were made in a material called Bakelite, which Bakelite is the very first plastic that we invented as humans, and we don't make it anymore. It's phenol-based. It's probably deadly, toxic, you know, to make it. It's a very beautiful material. If you don't recognize the name, you might know it from seeing it. It's a beautiful dark chocolatey brown tortoise is one of the most common forms of Bakelite. Some women know Bakelite because they made bangles, exquisitely colored red, green, Bakelite bangles. I became little by little invested in and really interested in the appearance of this obsolete technology, and again learned how very much attention was given to this domestic appliance, if you will, design consideration, eye appeal, eye candy, sexy looking, you know, objets to buy. I don't feel that happened with televisions. You know, momentarily, maybe people still think laptops are sexy. Momentarily, you know, apples went for that. Yeah. If you're old enough to remember the aqua orange and bubble looking G3s, they had that sort of, they were invested with appearance as important. Mm-hmm. But it is an obsolete technology that announces the era in which it was made very loudly because of these discrete designs from the 20s, from the 30s, from the 40s, from the 50s. They look like Jetson accessories. They could be on a Jetson show. And I didn't go much beyond the 50s in my appropriation of them as objects.
Thank you. And thank you, Constance and Joachim, for this lovely conversation. So we have a tradition of ending our lunch times with a poem, and you heard from him a little earlier today. And we're thrilled to welcome Uche Nduka to the stage. Uche Nduka is a Nigerian-American poet, essayist, and collagist. He is the author of 11 volumes of poems, of which the latest are Nine East and Living in Public. And City Lights will publish his new volume of poems titled Facing You this year. So welcome, Uche.
All right. Thank you for inviting me, all the crew in Brooklyn Royal. You've been publishing me for a while now, and I'm glad to be a part of this particular program, particularly in this moment in our history, where the issue of equity and police brutality has come up to the fore. The poem doesn't preach. The poem just gives you the language. You can make what you think of it. So I'd like to read from an ongoing series that I've just started writing. A few of them have been published online, might be the first or the about six of the series is online now. One was published a few days ago from a series called Speaking of Quish. That's just the title. So I'll read right from the notebook in which I'm writing. These are parakeets on top of an equestrian statue. Police shock hold on a man on the Rockaway boardwalk. Broken teeth, bloodied scalp, cupped hands, wandering trapdoors, black curtains, empty seats, false busts, talk of America's wannabe despot. The oppressed will no longer suffer in silence. Don't ignore his racism, his racist regalia, his need to turn back the clock to the Stone Age. A scandal-ridden presidency, riot shields, battle cruiser, those refusing to hold these psychopathic criminals in the police force to account. That gold lettering is trite, misleading lives callously taken. They overpromise, they underdeliver. Braggadocious of the reality show presidency. Rattlesnakes, automated bots, distraction bleeds, their willful ignorance of the pain of blacks in America. They still expect accolades for glorifying hate. Swastikas, burning crosses, slurs, shibboleths, racist tattoos. They are way behind this multicultural coalition of conscience, commode, armada, eyes of gadflies, messages cushioning distances, those antlers of night. Harder knocks, turpentine, fire, retaliation, the past and the present in a fist fight. The coming style, reparations, restitution, payback spies, bargains, grimy involvement, cobblestones, dreaming of fucking pros and cons of collective indulgence. The worst afternoons, a sinking image of the country, embezzled futures, emblems of disappointment. They wanted to be magnets for anger, confederacy of exploiters, valorization of brutality, where townhouses grumble, computer forensics, what imperious capitalism offers. Why should how things look be more important than how they actually are? When people turn on their taps, the water turns into blood. Is some fair, some die and become hashtags, while others die and become ancestors, meteors, fossils, a tough, a shaft to be shafted, bland dialogue, blog democracy, going bonkers at the cellular level, head games, political wickedness, plate tectonics, glass ceilings, lip service about equality, bullhorn, you get to shake hands with moody clouds, bonfire parties, lead in Milwaukee's water. They killed him for jogging while black, boot-looking muggy buffs, a reign of horror, the very unjust criminal system, the very unjust criminal justice system, toggling between dildos and revolvers, washing my quarrels with America become my children's quarrels with it. This is not a moment of closure. A disheartening graph, manic indelicacy, a country distancing itself from its wounded war veterans, goddamn bourgeois political rhetoric, hellish memorial services. Four white men set a black woman on fire with lighter fluid and they march at a stoplight in Wisconsin in June 2020. Third degree burns, Saharan plume, online petitions, signatures, days, months, years, bullies with badges, microplastics, cops violating their department's protocols, secret informants, escalation, extermination, indignation, political pollution, so unnecessary to put all of us under surveillance. We refuse deportation proceedings. We refuse appeasement, their prejudgment, wiretaps, cover-ups, a rogue presidency, opposition against the status quo need not be oblique. Apostates, upheavals of culture war, crooked profile of a nation desecrating itself, mourning wear, a dowdy sobriety, a brawling brown, blizzards of cruelty, injustice, flayed tossers, stolen embroideries, bloody sinews, sudden cardiac arrests in police custody, body cam footage of victims, poison fumes, auto traffic, bluster, growlers, murderous surveillance capitalism, viewable online, chainsaw, border fence, land theft, things getting pretty bad because they felt their power slipping away. Thank you.
Wow, thank you so much, Uche. That was incredibly powerful. And thank you again, Constance, for your generosity today, and Joachim for your thoughtful questions. This was a great conversation and a wonderful poem. And thank you all who came out today. Tomorrow we will have Sean Leonardo in conversation with our art scene editor, Sarah Ruffino, at 1 p.m. If you'd like to join us, we will be here. And you can now activate your microphones if you'd like to say goodbye or thank you as you leave. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Catherine. Thank you for inviting us. Thank you, Constance, for this wonderful conversation. I've enjoyed it myself enormously. I hope our audience has as well. Thank you. And by the way, there's something maybe I did not point out enough, which is the catalogue that I mentioned, that I showed, is a catalogue for an exhibition that was going to take place and was unfortunately interrupted. It's up almost entirely at our gallery in 205 Hudson, but it will resume when COVID-19 allows.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Joachim.
Thank you, David Carrier.
Thank you. What a beautiful reading, also.
Thank you, Fong. The reading was amazing.
Jeffrey, good to see you again.
Oh, beautiful.
Thank you, Constance. Hey, Sam.
Thank you.
Hi, hey,
Fong. Thank you, Fong.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Hi.